I in them, you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me, and I have loved them as you have loved me. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Lord, we thank you this morning for the reading of your word. We pray that the power of that word would come into our hearts and our hearts would burn with a recognition of the truth that you have spoken to our lives. That, Lord, we would abide and that we would be one, and the Lord would and the world would know that you are Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name, and we all said, amen. You may be seated. I've been preaching on the Christ-formed life, a life that's formed by God. We were formed, Adam was formed by the hands of the Lord out of the dust of the garden, and now we are being reformed from the inside out, that Christ is on the inside forming and shaping and molding us into the image of God. One of the things that I would say to us is that our goal is not to be like Christ, but that our goal is to be united to Christ. That there's no way through your own efforts that you'll ever become like Christ. There's nothing you can do that will make you be like him. But that he comes into us, and that all of a sudden we are united. We are one with God. And so we don't have to try so hard, right? Somebody in here, I go, whew, thank God that's over. And Paul makes his little prayer. He said, I'm praying, I am agonizing, I am travailing that you will be born, that Christ will be born within you. And it's a mystery, he writes to Colossians, that Christ in us is the hope of glory. And Jesus said, I've given them my glory, and that Christ in you is this glory, and that all of a sudden God is on the inside. And Paul understood it. He said, that it's no longer I that live, but it's Christ that lives within me. Say with me, it's not me. It's not me, it's Christ. Say, it's Christ on the inside of me. And that to live in communion with Jesus, that's our calling. To live united with God, to understand that what defines the Christian life is a participation in the very nature of God. The Hebrew writer says that we participate in the divine nature. Peter says that through the promises we participate. It's a little hard for us to understand, but do you know that if you take a t-shirt, a white t-shirt, and you dip it in blue dye, all of a sudden the t-shirt is blue. It's still a t-shirt, but now it's a blue t-shirt. If you take a glass of water and you take a tea bag and you drop a tea bag in it, all of a sudden it's now tea water. It's tea. You can't get the tea out of the water anymore. You can't get the... And that when Christ comes into you, you're no longer just human. But all of a sudden, the very presence, the Spirit, God Himself, Christ in us, permeates. And the Bible says you can't be separated. He said, you cannot separate you from me. I can't be separated from you. That to be born is to have the presence of God fused into your life, that if we could cut you open, that we'd find God in every cell of your being, in your mouth, in your head, in your toes, that now that anointing has permeated through your life. And so to be forgiven and to go to heaven is such a simplistic understanding of what it means to be born again. To be born again is not to ascend into heaven, but to have heaven descend into you. And that heaven is on the inside of you, and that Christ is now working in you and shaping you and transforming you, and that your DNA is now different, that you're not just a common man, but by the power of the Spirit, you're an uncommon being, that you're a God-like person, and that you don't have to, through your own sweat and blood, try to attempt to be like, but it is Him who is making you like Himself. Galatians, that Paul is writing to in chapter 1, verse 6, he said, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him who called you by the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there are some that would trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have news for you. In the church, the gospel is being perverted right now. In the church, the gospel of grace is perverted. It goes something like this. You're saved by grace, but you remain in by your behavior. You're saved by grace, but if you disbehave, you're no longer saved. I got to tell you, at 12 years old, I got saved 54 times in 52 weeks. Because every week I'd come back and he'd say, you're saved by grace, but... And we had all these rules that you weren't supposed to do and all these things you were supposed to do. Oh, wretched man am I, Paul writes, because I can't seem to do what I need to do and not do what I'm not supposed to do. Anybody else have that experience? And Paul is writing and said, you've perverted the gospel. You've twisted the gospel because we are saved by grace and not by works. That we are justified by faith in His grace. That there's nothing that you can do to ever earn your place in God. And it is a pure thing. That Romans 5:17 says you cannot achieve this. It is received. It's just received. You can't achieve it. All you can do is say thank you for it. It is this marvelous gift of grace. And until you have that whispered into your life, you will live a perversion. You will live by the perversion of the pulpits in the West today that pervert the gospel into a mixture of law and grace. And you will pervert it because you do not understand that God loves you and that He loves you unconditionally, that He loves you unreservedly, and that He has united Himself to you. And just as Jesus took upon the form of a flesh in the womb of Mary, the Spirit of Jesus takes upon the form of a flesh in the form of you. And just as Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, you can say, if you've seen me, you've seen Jesus. Am I making sense? See, we have this idea that there are good Christians, bad Christians, and horrible Christians. And then there's those people we want to kick out of the church. See, we have this idea that there are good Christians and bad Christians and really, really bad Christians. Can I suggest to you there's no such thing as a good Christian? Because the Bible says there's none good save Him. I got news for you. Everyone in this room is bad. I got news for you. No one in this room has ever behaved in such a manner that would make Jesus go, oh, I want that one. And that we have been twisted by the perversion of the gospel. And that what we need today is some people that stand up and say, I'm unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power unto God for salvation. That I am saved by the sheer mercy, the unmerited favor, that He chose me while I was yet a sinner, and that He continues to dispose His grace in me on a regular basis. And that to receive anything else is to hear Paul say, what has happened to you? You've allowed people to trouble you. Have you ever been troubled? You've allowed people to trouble you about whether or not Christ is in you. And you have been evaluating yourself based on these conditions. I can tell you, when the Lord whispered to me, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He has saved us. Titus 3 verse 5. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He has saved us. Say it with me. According to His mercy He has saved us. Say it again. According to mercy we are saved. And the Lord whispered to me and said, you will never earn your way into my approval, Quentin. You will never earn your way into my approval, but it is yours without condition right now. Say, right now, I have the approval of God. Right now, I have the grace, the mercy, the Christ of God in my life. Not because of anything I did or did not do, but because of what He has done. For grace you have been saved, and this is not by your works, but it is a gift from God. You see, grace is more than being forgiven. Grace is the capacity to experience and to live in Christ. Let me say it again. Grace is the capacity to experience and to live in Christ and Christ in you. I need grace every day to imagine that God is in me. I have to have grace every day to imagine that I am in God, to realize that I am one and that the T has dipped into my life and you cannot separate me from God and God from me. Say with me, nothing, nothing can separate me from God, that I am living a God-like life. But you do understand that we suffer from amnesia. We suffer as Jason Bourne. We forget the gifts and the talents that we have. And there are times and moments in our lives that something happens and we do this thing, but we can't figure out how we do that thing because we've forgotten that we're children and sons and daughters and joined to and one with. And so we're struggling with this forgetfulness that, and Paul says, I am praying that Christ would be formed in you again, that you'd be shaped by, that you'd get free of the need to perform or to evaluate or search for the approval of other people, that you would recover the reality that if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation, and that the old has passed away, and behold, all things have become new, and that God was in Christ, not imputing, not counting your sins against you. Now, this is just an interesting thought to me. God's not counting. God's not counting your sins. Then I want to ask a question. Who in heaven's name is? Because haven't you got up and gone through the day, and by the time you get to about 9, you're thinking, well, I did this, I shouldn't have done that, I shouldn't have done this, and then I did this. And by now you're just weary because, oh my God, this Christian thing is just impossible. I am no good. Why would God give me a raise? Why would God heal me? Why would God bless me or favor me? Because after all, and there's this accounting going on, and the Bible says that God is not counting your sins against you. Then I got this question, who the heaven is counting? You. It's you. Say you. You know, one of the reasons you can't get demons out of people is because it's them. Amen. There's some things you cannot cast out because if I cast it out, you die. You're the one that's against you. God's not against you, but you're against you. And the reason you're against you is because you've accepted a perverted gospel that says that if you can have grace, but you got to behave, and if you don't behave, you're bad, and if you're bad, you don't. And it's going on in your head. It's really in your head. And so you're going, ta-ching, 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 ta-ching. By the time you get to the end of the day, you're like, you're just depressed. You're just depressed. And guess who's depressing you? You. You're oppressing yourself. And if you try to cast yourself out, it just doesn't work. Because you can't cast you out. You have to convert yourself. You have to convert yourself. You have to be transformed. You have to be reformed. You have to think differently about yourself, that you're saved by grace, that you don't deserve it. You don't earn it. But I want to look at people sometimes and say, just stop counting. I remember a lady coming down. She stood right there. And she told me this stuff in her life. And I said, oh, honey, you're forgiven. She said, I am not. So I backed up and I went through the theological discourse about how Christ was her substitutionary lamb that died on the cross and that his blood redeemed her from and that all she had to do is receive Jesus. She says, I am not. I stood there for a minute and I thought, okay. And I stood there for a minute and I said, well, honey, here's the problem. Christ has forgiven you, but you haven't forgiven yourself. And she says, exactly. You didn't help, and walked off. See, nobody else can judge you if you stop judging yourself. Nobody else can condemn or convict you if you don't condemn and convict yourself. And if the Holy Spirit speaks to you something, there's a way out. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Say with me, nobody else is counting. I need to be delivered from my religious self. I've blamed the church for 50 years about them being too religious. And the truth of the matter is I've been... that I'm the one that put me in this perversion of the gospel because I've never heard the whisper of God that says, I love you unconditionally, that by grace you are saved. So before you start saying the churches, the denomination, could I just deal with the religious Pharisee inside of yourself? The religious Saul that's inside of you that's trying to earn the approval of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. I might challenge you this morning to dare to live a forgiven life. I know. To dare to live a life that's one with God. To dare to abide in the presence of God. To dare to receive the grace of God. To dare to claim that He is in you. Could I just suggest to you that one encounter with God will alter you? That this Paul that's writing to the Galatians, this Paul that's writing to the Corinthians, this Paul that's writing to the Ephesians and the Colossians, this Paul that's defending that grace is sufficient, had an experience. And I understand, everybody wants Paul's experience. And I want to say, no, you don't. No, you don't. You don't want that experience because it's a long way from the back of that donkey to the dust of the ground. You do not want to fall on your face. It's a long way. No, you don't want to, because when you wake up in that dust, you're going to be blind. And now that you're blind, you're going to have to be led somewhere and you don't know where. You don't really, experience is not the best teacher. Other people's experience is a better teacher. I've been telling kids that for 35 years, son. It's not that you have to experience it, it's that you can learn it from your father's experience. And that sometimes just don't do what your dad did. And if you don't do what your dad did, it's better than having the... Well, I can't tell my kids not to have sex before marriage because... Can I tell you something? We need to recover that we were created for purity between one another. That's what we were created for. And that sometimes we're just the bad example. Oh, well. Paul had an experience. And the first thing that happened is he was Saul, but now he's Paul. Say with me, he was Saul, now he's Paul. I mean, somebody would say Saul, and he would answer. They'd go, hey, Saul, here'd go Paul. He'd get there, and they'd go, we didn't call you. Saul, he'd go running. He'd get there, and go, we didn't call you. Say with me, his name's Paul. You know, sometimes you people are answering to the wrong name. Hey, sinner. Hey, stupid. Hey, sick. Hey, dummy. Hey, good for nothing. Hey, never going to amount to anything. Hey, you know, you need to quit answering to the name that was yesterday, because God's given you a name, and today it's Son of God. Today it's Daughter of God. Today it's saved. It's whole. Start answering to the right name. My name used to be Saul, but it's not Saul anymore. It used to be Abram, but now it's Abraham. Quit answering to who you used to be and answer to who God's called you to be. Quit answering to the wrong name. First thing God does is change his name. The second thing he does is change the game. The game was to eradicate those Gentile Christians from the church. The game was to keep it pure, to evaluate, to judge, to determine who is in and who is out. Well, can they go to heaven and live like that? That was the game. Now the game is, hey, if you want to go, you can come. Now the game is, he died for everyone. Jews, Gentiles, men, women, red, yellow, black, and white. Y'all come now because we can go. The game was to defend who got in. Now it's to let everybody in that wants to come. The church is still playing who can come, who can go, who is good, who is bad. The church is still playing that game. Can I tell you, that's a perverted gospel. You mean you let them people come to your church? You let sinners come to your church. Last time I checked, that's the only people that could attend. Last time I checked, the only pond I had to fish in was a bunch of sinners. Last time I looked, if we didn't let sinners in here, we'd have shut the doors. Even though, you know, God does not hate sinners. He hates people that believe they're not. Hello. There ain't not one of you in here that is without sin. Because he who says he has no sin deceives himself and perverts the gospel. No, there ain't nobody in here. We're all in need of God's grace today. Because grace is more than the forgiveness of our sins. Grace is the capacity to experience and to live in Christ. And Christ in you. I have to have grace every day to have the ability to believe. Wow, he's in here. And I'm in him. And we're one with one another. He didn't come into us because of what we do right. He comes into us because of what he's done right. We're all the prodigal son, and we have to come to our own senses and return home. See, it's not an invitation to be saved. It's an invitation to come home. abide, dwell, settle down, make your home with me, and I'll make my home with you. That's the invitation. The invitation is not to be perfect. The invitation is to get married. The invitation is to be joined together in such an ontological way that he changes you. And that all of a sudden, instead of being a mere mortal, you are a miracle. You sang it this morning, the God of miracles. Can I tell you, the miracle is not what you think it is. The miracle is that God takes mortals and makes them immortal. The miracle is that God moves into you, and now you're not just a human being, you're a human being in Christ. That's the miracle. All the rest of the stuff are fruit. They're fruit. Healings are fruits. They're all fruits. They're the byproducts of you being grafted into a vine. See, all of life is about getting you into position to hear the presence of God. That as I spoke to you last week, whatever he says, do it and wait. Whatever he says, do it and wait. That's the process of the miraculous, and Abraham, Noah, and Elijah, and David, and Esther, and Ruth, and Peter, and Paul. They all heard the whisper of God's grace and mercy that he had come to them. And that if you hear that whisper and you do what he says, you're in position to be transformed. You're in position to be made one with Samuel, Samuel. Here I am, O Lord, speak. The church today must move through the perversion of a twisted gospel of grace and recognize that God is whispering to you as he would speak to a friend, a son, a daughter, a child. I can remember holding my firstborn son and holding that child and realizing love. That this child came from the union of his mom and I, and this love, and the Lord spoke to me, I love you more than you love your son. How's that possible? This is something that is the product of a union between two people. I said, I love you more. And the love of God continued to explode. I remember laying on an office in a room and just dirty, and the Lord said, I want you. Why would anybody want? I remember Annie and I touching elbows as the Lord says, you're moving here. Whispers. Grace is the capacity to experience and live in Christ. And the way you do that is listen to the whispers, and he orders your steps and takes you this way and turns you this way and positions you for the next whisper. Just pray, son, just pray. Give grace, son, give grace. Each of these in areas that were difficult, each of them in challenging moments. I remember walking that sand hill out there, and there wasn't much there, and the Lord said, from here you will reach the world. And I just had people ask me, why are you still in Hutchinson? I said, because he said, from here. From here. Well, but you could have moved here. There's an airport, and you could have done this. I said, from here. You see, when God whispers, it's not a negotiation. When he whispers something to you. I remember driving in the driveway one night. I was exhausted. I'd counseled. I'd blah, blah, blah. And I get about halfway down that lane. And the Lord says, have you saved the best for those that love you the most? I had saved nothing. See, you can save the world and lose your soul and lose your family. I'd save nothing. See, we have been joined to God by the whispers of the grace that continues to impart to us the grace that we need for today. How many believe that? That you need grace for today. You need to have grace to understand his abiding presence in our lives. Abide in me and I in you. As I am in the Father and the Father is in me. This is an amazing thing that we've been invited to be a part of this vine, that we've been invited to share in the life of the vine. Can I just suggest to you that the same life that comes through the vine is the same life that flows out the branch? Can I encourage you to go home and look at your tomato plant? That tomato plant is not going, tomato, 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 tomato. No, that branch does not speak the tomato into existence. You've never stood by a tree and it go, apple, 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 apple. Because the tree never speaks the apple into reality. No, the branch is connected to the vine. And the life of the vine flows through the branch, and it is miraculous and without effort. If you abide in me and I abide in you, you'll produce fruit that will last. It's not fruit you control. It has to do with being connected to the vine. That we've been added to the vine who has life in himself. So what do? We stay connected to the vine. We abide in the vine. We stay in the unity and in the oneness. And for 2,000 years, this thing has been splintered and cut 100 different ways, and we called it pruning. No, what it really was is, I don't like you. That's not pruning. That's judgment. Because the Bible says the Father is the vine dresser. You don't do the pruning. He does. And you do understand, he only prunes that because it's produced so much, he wants the life to go to a new branch, and he's going to slip over here. Oh, you're not listening. Abide. Abide in the grace. Abide in the Christ. Abide in the whispers of God. It's so interesting to me that John 15 comes after John 14, and after John 15 comes John 16. It's so interesting. That sandwiched in between there is this John 15, that in John 14, he said, the Father dwells in me. In John 16, he says, I'm going to send another one to you, and the Holy Spirit will teach you all things. Sandwiched between the Father in me and the I will send the Spirit is I am the vine. People say, where do you get the Trinity? From the Bible. Well, the word Trinity is never used. Well, read your book and get the point. There's the Father, there's the Son, there's the Holy Spirit. It's in the book. Do you also know that in your Bible it doesn't say repeat after me? But the same people that don't like the word Trinity are the same people that don't like that use the word repeat after me. Say, the Father in God. I'll send you the Holy Spirit. I'm the Son. That there is this Trinitarian family. That God is three in one. And that we need to experience the work of the Father, the work of the Son, and the work of the Holy Spirit. And that the Father provides grace, the Son provides grace, and the Holy Spirit gives us grace. We listen, we obey. So here's the real question I'm trying to get to this morning. How do we receive the grace of God? The grace is free, right? The grace is without measure. The grace. How do we, on a rhythmic, daily, weekly, monthly year, as we walk through life, how do we receive this grace of the infusion of the Christ that changes us and changes? How do we receive that? Well, number one, if you're evangelical, it's by the Word, right? If you abide in me and my word abides in you, say with me, the word. So if you're evangelicals, it's when the teaching and the preaching of the word takes place and your heart is strangely warmed, right? So you receive grace because of the preaching of the word. Say with me, the word. How many believe that? So that when I hear the preaching of the word, when I read the word, grace comes into me and I'm abiding in God. Anybody here? How many need that? How many of you are charismatic, Spirit-filled Pentecostals, and so you receive the Spirit, and the Spirit brings things to your mind, and the Spirit gives you words of knowledge and words of wisdom, and the Spirit guides and directs you, and all of a sudden there's healings, there's signs, and there's wonders, and the Spirit of God gives you grace and power and mercy. How many of you receive that through the Holy Spirit? And that's there, right? And how many of you know that with the Word without the Spirit can lead to some perversion, and that the Spirit without the Word can lead to, that you need both working together, right? And how many of you understand that there's another area of the church, and it says to repent and be, say, baptized. In other words, God uses physical things to convey spiritual realities. That he takes the water, he baptizes you, and the water symbolizes your death and the resurrection of Jesus, right? He uses water, and that God uses physical things to convey spiritual realities. We charismatics are more sacramental than we want to admit because we believe we can lay a hand on somebody and God uses our hand to convey healing. And yet, if we start talking about the sacramental church, we go, oh, what? And the Bible says that I am the bread and I am the living water. And as often as you come together, say, obey this. Listen and obey. Well, I don't believe this. You're a word person, and the word that you say is God tells you to break the bread, pour the wine, and God will be with you. Now, that's what it says. So, what I'm trying to say to you is there are three distinctive ways to receive the grace of God. The word that's taught and preached, the spirit that is received from heaven, and obedience. Because we have already understood that it's not by your behavior that you get the grace of God. The obedience that he's talking about is whatever he says, do it. Pour this water in that pot. Take that pot over here, pour it out, and it will become wine. Take this bread, pray over it, break it, hand it to people. Take this cup, pour this, and drink it, and I will be with you. You'll be one. How many of you understand you need all three? It has nothing to do with being Protestant or Catholic or Methodist or Baptist or Pentecostal. It has to do with listen to what he says, do what he says, and then wait. Because it's in the process. The miracle is in whatever he says, do it, and wait. And it became wine. How do we abide in? How do we remain one with? We listen. We do what he says, and we wait for the fruit. And you don't get to make this up. This is not a self-constructed church. You don't get to make the church up. This isn't the church of Quentin or the Bruce or of Dale. It's the church of Jesus Christ. And so however he says to do it, you do it. Here's the word, and in the word you find things he says. Baptize, lay hands on the sick, eat the bread, drink the wine, and wait for the fruit. And that if you do that, and you do that, and you stay consistent, that it's not a once-in-a-while thing. And that you gather together, because we come together to do this, because I need Kent that has a word. I need Heather that says, I forgive you. I need Bruce that says, I forgive you, and we forgive one another. And whosoever sins we forgive, they are forgiven. And we update, and we lose our amnesia, and suddenly Jason Bourne is born again. And but you see, today we market the church and we come to church to get what we need. And we don't understand that the church is here so that the graces of God and the Christ in us is revealed in us and through us to a world that needs it. We're not here for us, we're here for the world. That one of these days we will be gone and the world will be lost. That, sweetheart, brothers and sisters, we're not here so that you feel good. We're here so that the presence of God is made real through us to a world that doubts us. And that if we'll become one with God by his grace and his whispers, the world could be reached in a moment. I've actually contemplated, why would anybody get saved in the first, second century of the church? Why would anybody join the church? I mean, they were killing Christians. If you got saved, they stood there, and if you got baptized, went, take them over there and throw them in that pen, and next Tuesday we're going to throw them in front of the lion and let the lions eat them and go, take this one, take them over to Carthage. And over there in Carthage, we have gladiators, and we'll cut their heads off next Thursday, and people... So we don't go to basketball games or football games. We go to games where people get ripped apart. And we applaud it. Am I making any sense? So on May the 7th, 203, Petrura and Felisa are captured and they're taken into the cage under the Colosseum at Carthage. Them along with about 15 others are being prepared for the games in about 8 weeks. Because we want to fatten them up so that they're strong, so they can run from the lions and scream. And Keturah was of a rich family, but Phylicia was of a poor family, and she was about 6 months pregnant. And so they went and got Soterius, and Soterius was a leader that could teach you about the grace of God. And Soterius volunteered to go into prison and to die with those so that he could have 8 weeks so that he could bring them through catechesis. We don't think we have to go to any learning. But he teaches them for 8 weeks about the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the hope of life that's found in Jesus. And so when the day comes, they strip them naked. The baby had been born a week ago. The baby is handed to the jailer's wife. Milk still dripping from the woman's breast as she walks out naked. And the bulls gouge them, toss them in the air. And they lay naked and unconscious. And they loose the tigers and some of the others. And Soterius is ripped by the claws of a lion. And they say not a word. And they crawl to one another in the center of the arena. And they stand and they huddle. And they begin to kiss each other's cheek. If I ask you to share the peace and kiss one another, you think I've lost my mind. These people are consoling one another. These people are in love with Jesus and they're patiently awaiting their deliverance, which will not look like what you want. And in the face of imminent death, they are patiently enduring the tribulations of the moment. And the crowd goes, because they're not running. They're not screaming. They're not cursing. They are patiently enduring. You do understand that if you add patience to your faith, you lack nothing. That love is patient and kind. That it is long-suffering. And that when love displays patience, that love comes back to those that it shares the faith with and kisses one another and waits for the hope. It's not trying to change the world through its words. Cyprian would write about this event and said, "We do not speak great words, we live great lives." I am so tired of an American church that thinks they can argue with the government, that thinks they can argue with one another and find the perfect doctrine. The question is, have you got grace to experience and live in the Christ today? No matter what you face, no matter what you live, we're headed to the cross. We're following the man that carried a cross and died, blessing those that crucified him. That is our faith. Not how to get rich in 2 years. Not how to make all the sicknesses in the world go away. But how to live lives that have been indwelled by the Christ. Lives that when they look at us, it takes their breath away and they see the Christ. There's the Christ. Because every time they put a Christian into the arena, they did not respond in fear. They didn't run. They held each other. They gathered together. Remembered the meal that they shared last night. Kissed one another on the cheeks. Probably, it says they broke out in singing. Well, they didn't have our songs. So maybe they were just singing the hymn, the psalms. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. They knew Christ was in them, Dale. They were living in Christ. Christ was living in them. And their witness was not with words, They lived in patience. They were unhurried. They were unpredictable. They were unstoppable. And the gospel kept exploding and exploding, because people would walk out of that arena and go, what kind of people are those? We're preaching a perverted gospel in America. We're preaching a gospel, a grace plus law. We're preaching a gospel where everything you need is taken care of. We're not preaching a gospel where Christ in you can stand in the perseverance of all persecution. We don't come in here on Sunday morning to get our needs met. We come in here on Sunday morning to receive the graces of God. Amen. The graces of God that empower us to live out in the world in such a way they are one with God. They are one with one another. Christ is in them, and the world would believe. So to walk out of here this morning and walk into a world and have Christ-filled lives. Yeah, this doesn't attract all the people in the world. It's dangerous to live by the whispers of God, to listen, to obey, and to wait, to preach the word, to receive the sacraments, and to wait on the Holy Spirit. Wow! To be able to stand against all things. Whatever he says, do that. It's in the process that the miracle happens. And then you go to Matthew's gospel, and the centurion comes running in and says, I've got a sick servant. And Jesus said, I'll go home with you. And the centurion says, I'm unworthy for you to come to my house. Just say the word. The Bible says Jesus marveled at the faith of the centurion. I want to be a guy that marvels God. Right? God marvels me, but I'd like to be the guy that marvels God. I'd like to be the guy that makes Jesus go, wow, wow. I've lived by whispers all my life. Ask my wife, ask my children, ask anybody around me. I lived by whispers my entire life. I want to be the guy that looks at Jesus and say, just say it. I'll do it. To get up every morning and go, just say it, Lord. And I'll go do it. Just say it. And I'll serve communion. Just say it. And we'll sing that song again. Just say it. And we'll lay hands on the sick. Just say it, and I'll preach till 2. Just say it, and we'll go to Mexico. Just say it, and we'll go to the Vatican. Just say it. How about you this morning? Would you live a life on the way to the cross that you could look at the Master and say, whatever you say, I'll do it. Because if we become people that just look at Him and just say it, there's nothing. It's not so much about what I say. It's about how I live in response to what He has said. And I've rather made up my life that I'm going to become a reflex person. You know, if they teach you CPR, but you have to stop and think about it before you do it, you don't know it. I can remember Sherry. She didn't stop and think about it. It was reflex. Bam, boom. That'll save your life. Reflex will save your life. If you'll spend time in the Word, in prayer, forgetting the past and focusing on Jesus, you will train your spirit, your mind, and your body that you won't stop and think about how you're reacting. It'll just be habit. You'll just reflex to it because you've been trained to do whatever He says. Be patient. Stay in training. Just be patient. Stay in training. Just listen. Just obey. And just wait for it. Why does that church do what it does? Because when we read the Word, whether Bruce reads it, whether David reads it, whether Tammy reads it, whether I read it, it doesn't matter who reads it. Just read it. Just sit there and listen to the Word. The grace of God will come. It doesn't matter whether I'm preaching. Why do you preach so good? Because it doesn't matter if I do. Because it's not about me. Just listen to the preaching of the Word. Wait in the Spirit. Break the bread. Pour the wine. Baptize converts. Dedicate babies. Marry people. Just do what He says to do. And all of a sudden, the church becomes the embassy of heaven on earth, and the graces of God are flowing through the church, and the people in the church are becoming like Christ. And we go out into the world, and our shadow heals people. We just walk by. We don't have to say nothing, because it's not what we say that's great, it's what we do that's great. I just want to be that person. Just speak a word. Just speak a word, Lord. Just speak the word, Lord. And I'll do it. Would you just lift your hands in this holy, consecrated gathering? Consecrated by Scripture, by Spirit, by sacrament, by the grace of God. Give us the capacity to experience and to live in You, and You in us. Give us patience to stand in the midst of persecution and forgive others.